Hello everyone, welcome to our second video in Virtual Brain, and today I will be analyzing a chess game, Donald Byrne vs Robert Dreams Special, both really popular players, and this game started with knight f3, the red key opening, but it converted to a rook f4. C4, and though this looks like King's Indian, the bishop f4 was converted to rather a brinkman attack. And queen b3, now it resembles a Russian with bishop f4 or a brinkman with queen b3. d4, queen c4, c6, and white has a double attack, as you can see on the c7 pawn. So it would be best to protected with c6, advancing e4, just collecting more space, collecting the center. Knight d7, developing the knight. Developing the bishop, there's no sensible square to develop it to. Whereas knight d7, knight b6 could be a clear concrete idea. Rook d1, supporting the d4, pawn. Knight b6, attacking the queen and developing the knight to a better square. Queen c5, getting away from the attack, and bishop to g4. Now he developed the bishop. We have bishop to g5, and his idea with bishop to g5 is just to copy, waste a little time. Maybe bishop captures f6, bishop captures f6, etc. Here, Fischer plays one of the brilliant sacrifices in this game, knight a4. And here it's a short and nice combination, and actually white play queen a3, but if knight captures a4, then knight captures e4, queen to b4, a5, queen captures b7, knight captures g5, and if you capture with knight captures g5, bishop captures d1, king captures d1, queen captures d4, and you are simply losing. And if you don't, and for example you play something like queen captures c6, then rook c8 here seems good, and also capturing is simply winning. Anyway, let's back up and see the true variation. You play queen to a3, suspecting this variation, and then there was knight captures c3. The sack won't have any point anymore, and b captures c3. Queen captures c3 was also there, but then the knight into e4 was coming, and he thought it would be better to at least support his d4 pawn and at least keep a better safe center. And b captures c3, knight captures e4, bishop captures e7, all just capturing pawns as usual. He captures here, he captures here, those seems like a fork. Here, he gets queen to b6, bishop to c4. So, what if he plays bishop captures f8? Let's see. Then I guess bishop to f8 and queen b3, attempting to exchange. Queen into b3, king into b3, and I guess rook e8. And this king is kind of trapped in here. So I guess it would be a winning position. Maybe plus one, maybe. Excuse me, minus one or something like that. So let's continue with the main variation. He didn't capture, he played bishop to c4, which I think is the best move. And here, after bishop to c4, I played knight, he played c3. And if he didn't capture c3, okay, e8 is coming, and it's a pin on the bishop, and the king is stranded in the center. So if he castles, then he just loses a pawn. And if he continues with castling, then he's just gonna lose a pawn. He's just gonna lose a bishop on e7, so he's just lost a pawn on c3. Whereas if he defends it, queen e3, then his king is stranded in the center. There's nothing he can do. He's just gonna lose. Well, the game continued. Bishop to c5, attacking the queen. And now, rook to e8, delivering the check. King to f1 is more than forced. And here, Fischer plays one of the most popular moves known in chess. Bishop to e6. It's a brilliant idea to, and Fischer knew he would be able to win this game after a long calculated combination. Bishop captures b6, bishop captures c4, king to g1, knight to e2, king to f1, knight to d4. So as you see, anything, he can go around capturing anything right here. So he can continue going to any square, and the king can't do anything about that because he can't go to the e1 square, and the f1 square is being checked by this, and the g1 square is always checked when the knight comes back to e2, and then he moves away again. So this is not looking great for white at all. He plays king to g1, knight to e2, king to f1, knight to c3, king to g1, a captures b6, attacking the queen, queen to b4, defending the queen, rook to a4, attacking the queen again, queen captures b6, knight captures d1, and now rook e1 is a threat if the knight on f3 moves, which is not going to happen immediately, but there are a lot of pieces and it's looking pretty bad for white already. So after h3, rook captures a2, so he can checkmate on the, if possible, he might be able to checkmate on the 8/1st rank. King h2, escaping with the king. Knight captures f2, capturing the pawn just naturally. Rook e1, as you can see, it was attacked, so he just moves it away, and it's just going to be an exchange on e1. But queen to d1 first, queen to d8, excuse me, delivering check, and bishop f8. He doesn't want this huge diagonal probably for black to have, and he maybe want to transfer his queen inside this way. Bishop f8, knight e1, and bishop to d5, locking in the queen in the d5. Secondly, it's creating a huge attack on the g2 pawn and the king side. Knight f3 defending the g2 pawn, knight to e4. So this knight to e4 seems very bad, but actually it's one of the best moves because it just seems to win in almost every way. There could be an knight d2 coming on, there could just be something quiet, and then the king g7, then knight f6, and then bishop f3, and he might have thought of a sudden combination. So there are so many options, but and black simply seems to be winning here. Queen to b8 is trying to defend the king side with this huge diagonal. Excuse me, guys. Not the best in putting arrows. B5. So that of B5 is to protect the B7 pawn, and it's just simply advancing. So if he sacrifices the queen, the pawns can promote, and it will just be a win. So there comes H4. So maybe he's planning king h3. There are a lot of plans which white can try, but none seem to be working out. H5, blocking out H4, H5 coming up anytime soon. Knight e5. So the idea of knight e5, the idea of knight e5 is to probably bring extra pressure. He's probably thinking, I'm done defending, there's nothing I can do with defending anymore. And the only way to try to get something out of this is to try and put pressure and get a win. Because black's pressure on the king side is huge in the knight and the king alone cannot stand it. He's probably thinking, let me take my knight out, let me bring my queen inside, and let me try to get something out of this. And it continues. King g7. So he's doing a lot of things with this move. He's first of all unpinning this bishop to move around with this diagonal. He's also getting the f6 square, securing the f6 and h6 square very well. King g1, he's out of moves. He doesn't want any pin like bishop to d6 coming up. So he simply brings his king back. And now Fischer plays a really nice combination which I like. Bishop to c5, king to f1, knight to g3 check, king to e1, which is again forced, bishop to b4, and king to d1, again forced, bishop to b3, king to c1, again forced, knight to e2 check, king to b1, which is again forced, knight to c3 check, king c1, and rook c2 check. A beautiful game by Fischer. Just sacrificing the queen, and knowing that his pieces will coordinate well enough in the attack so that he'll be able to get a good advantage and win the game. And it was pretty much, I think, it is one of my favorite games, and it's pretty much one of the legendary games which will never, a coach would never stop teaching this to many students. And this game just has a ton to offer, and it's one of the most tactical games ever. So hope you enjoyed this video, hope you learned something. Thank you all.